completed the sunflower painting, now I go on to frame number two, and I decided I'd have a go at this poppy one. Although I've done a couple of plein air poppies this summer, which is much more exciting and more fun out of doors, let's see how we can explore this textural way of working with the rake brushes and so on to apply it to this field of poppies with this large tree in the background, get all these atmospherics. Now in this case I'm going to use two photographs. The main composition drawn out here already, as you can probably just see, is this one. But I also want more in the foreground, so I'm going to use this one to bring in larger poppies in the foreground. So what we'll do first is we'll work on the background first, the sky and the tree, the hill here, and we'll work then through all the texture of the grasses and we'll place the poppies on top. Now, because the acrylics are slightly thinner than the oils, I think I may have to do a technique here where I put white back onto the painting where I want these poppies to be able to get the brightness I want out of them. So we'll see about that. Okay, so I'm going to start off with my large filbert again. This is number 10, and we'll have a go at the sky. We'll work in the deeper tones first, the blues, but a rather nice cerulean blue down to turquoise here, and then coming up to the warmer cobalts. Again, when you're working with lighter colours, and you're going to start with white in any colour, always put a little bit of white in first. It also gives me more body for the colour as well, so I'm going to add a little bit of white in, a small touch of water just to thin it slightly, and I'm going to take some cerulean blue here. It's rather lovely. And look at this area here where the lighter cerulean blue is. It's going to go right into the tree, coming through here. It's going to become warmer in a minute as well. I'm going to add more warmth into it. Of water. This is Mount Card we're painting on. It's acid-free, high-quality Mount Card. And I'm going to add a little bit more warmth into that. I'm going to take a bit of cobalt now and just put a little bit more warmth into this blue down here. So we get a nice blending of the cerulean into the cobalt while it's still damp, while it's still wet. I can just feather it in. Back to that cerulean again, and just slightly darker as it comes into here. It's a little bit of mess got into it that I don't like, so I'm going to just bring that through. There we go. And then feathering that up and in here. It comes off towards the outside there. Bringing up this cobalt blue now, the mixture, a bit of white in it, and we'll bring that right up. I'm going to bring the light clouds over it shortly. You see I'm changing my brush strokes as well. I'm not bringing the brush strokes all in one direction, I'm getting the effects of these clouds already, I'm thinking about the cloud effects, already making the brush strokes about what I have here on the painting. Slightly heavier now with the paint, slightly darker with this blue. Comes right up through here off the edge of the paper. And I'm making it slightly transparent, but I'll bring the clouds over that later. Up into here. Comes right down. And a little bit more of the cerulean now, a little bit of white, keep the white going as it comes down through here. Just a tad of the cerulean coming in around the tree, changing my brush strokes backwards and forwards to get the feeling of these fluffy clouds, and I'm going to add on top shortly. So I'm about ready now to look at starting on the clouds. May lighten that up again a bit later. Let's put some more light colour in there. Right, I want to start with my mid-greys, and the simplest way to make a grey is to add brown to the blue. So taking the same blue that I had, a fraction more cerulean, and adding a bit of white to that again. This time I'm working the other way, I'm working up from the darks to the lights. A little touch of burnt sienna. I'm getting some lovely greys already, but it wants to be quite a light grey, quite a warm one, so I'm going to add more burnt sienna to this mix to give myself a really light warm grey. Let's just try that. still too dark, so add some more white to it. This is why I say start from your white and work the other way, because otherwise you can end up with some very dark colours, and also you'll be using an awful lot of paint. Now, come up with my grey there, all the way across to the edge. A little bit more water, keep the water going. And when my brush gets a little bit dry in a moment, you're going to see me using this in a more dry brush feathered way. Right up to the edge here. You can see I've got a blue-grey going on my brush. Right across. Tree. Yeah. Up and out. All the way down to the sky there. Blending it just over the edge of the sky. Feathering it in there as my brush dries out a bit now. Feathering it in. Fluffing it up just across the edge of that sky so it becomes a soft edge. It'll come through into that tree. I'm making it a bit thinner where the tree is so that I can see where things are. But the light just shows through between the tree in a moment. Carry on with that grey, mix plenty up. We're all the way down around here now. Wasn't quite enough, but I'll mix up some more and it'll be a tad warmer this time. Bit of white into it. So a little bit more brown in there. Bit more white, don't want it too dark. So it's a tad warmer grey. Coming down as it goes over the horizon. Up into the trees here. You'll see the method to my madness shortly and why I'm doing it this way soon. That warm's coming up into there. So we get this lovely warm grey of the clouds mixing with the cool grey of the clouds. So if you like, I'm painting in my mid-tones first. I'm going to go to my lighter and darker ones afterwards. A little bit more white, a little bit of water into it. Let's go lighter still. Get a lovely luminous effect. Tickle, tickle, tickle all the way across. Keep tickling the paint on, building up these shapes, working around these fluffy white forms. Tickling back and forth, finding these gentle layers of cloud as I build them up, almost in glazes, but not quite. And you see how we're starting to get the cloud glowing out at us. We'll use water to blend it and feather that back in as well to get some lovely soft effects again. Again, we go lighter still. This time a little touch of chrome yellow into it. And we're going to start really picking out these very light bits of cloud now. As the sun just gleams through. And now you can see the fluffiness of the cloud just starting to build up. Layers of grey showing through from behind. We've also almost caught up with the light on the tree now, you'll notice. It's almost merging in because it's got so light with the tree, and that's what we were after, is to gradually catch up with that light that's coming through here. So an interesting way to build up a sky from soft to warm, from soft to stronger. And get this lovely soft glazing of colours. And now, again, back. Let's go right back again to the beginning and back to the blue. Because we might need to just put a bit more back into this. Right, we'll leave the sky at that for the moment. We need to do the tree next. Right, now it's time to start at some of the darker colours, I'm going to go down the brush size. This one, and mix up some quite dark colour. So I'm going to take my Prussian blue and a bit of bouncy inner and make it quite warm. And I'm going to go straight into my tree trunk here. And see how dark that is. See, it's one colour against another. It won't look right until we get all the colours one next to another. So what we're going to try and do normally is keep the whole painting going at once, so no one piece is finished. Otherwise we're liable to get it wrong, leaving a bristly edge look for the hedge. So I can tart up later and make into more of a rough edge. So it's just an underpainting, remember, this is just to get the basic tones here before I pull it into detail later. Just let the brush do the work for you. And we're going to do the same up into the tree now. Plenty of paint, mix up plenty of paint, make sure you've got plenty of that. Bit of water on it, and away I go. Right, this tree trunk comes up to here, fattens out a bit. Comes over. Just use the tip of the brush to tickle in the effects of these leaves. Going right out and round. You can see just by pushing the brush downward and working it backwards and forwards, I can get the effects of these leaves coming out here. Great fun, and it's not so difficult, it's just technique. Leaving the light shining through, again right through here, up, down, round. Bits of leaf just shining out there. You can always put the lights back in afterwards, as I'm going to do. I'm not going to leave all the lights showing now. I'm going to put some lights back in here later. Get the way this tree flows through. So again, darker still, more paint, brown, more blue, deeper colour. Really work into it until you feel happy with the shape. Don't like the shape, but we can always put some light back on again. I don't think we're far off on the shape I want there. You start to see how the brown with the blue has gone to a very sort of dark green colour. Now I'm putting in these darker shades of blue. It's giving a quite different effect, giving us the shadow of the tree. We've got these lovely darks in it now, and it's got a vibrance to it. It's got some depth to it. Because there are darks and there are darks. I mean, there are warm darks, there are cool darks, they're different. Right, that's trees all right for now. Now I want to come down and coat the whole of this in a fairly dark colour again. I'm going to take some yellow ochre and add it to that same colour I was just mixing, because I want a nice warm dark yellow ochre colour right down through here. Let's try that out. Yes, I want that to be my main colour all the way through that, to Prussian blue, yellow ochre, that lovely sort of warm deep green. And while that's drying off, I'm going to take the same colour, yellow ochre, just lighten it a little with a bit of yellow ochre and a little bit of the bright green. And we'll just paint some of these umbrella shapes, they'll sink back a bit I'm sure, coming across the tree here, just to get the feeling of light coming through. You see how easy it is, how much fun it is, just to give the impression of something from a distance. Just feel these leaves coming around here, down, as parasols. And you see, I've almost got a tree there now. It's almost done, and I can go back and I can fiddle with it, as I'm going to do, but it is almost done. So quickly. We can do the same here with these bits of hedge. Just indicate onto them, just tickle on the little bits of hedge growing up and out. I'll use a finer brush later to get even more detail. all the way down, right into the grasses here, just with the filbert. I'm using it dryly at the moment. Right, while I'm at it, I'm going to go back up to the tree here and just use a small filbert to tidy up this bit here. We've got a lovely light bit there of corn behind. I just want to get that in there. So from there, right through here, slightly into this shape, got, if I can get in onto my brush, I've got some corn coming down all the way through here, comes into there, and there we are. We've already got a lovely effect of light happening there. Now I want a small pointy brush. I'm going to need to just tidy up my tree with the light colour we were using earlier. So white, a little touch of yellow ochre in a minute. Tiniest touch just to warm it up a bit. There we go. And that comes in between the tree trunk here. Comes down that side of the tree, draw it in down here, and then we've got little bits of light just shining through in between the tree and places here. So now I'm starting to put some of the light back in that I've taken out around the edges here. It's a lovely thing to do, painting light back in again. Before I go on to working on the flowers here, I'm going to put a little bit more work into the sky. I just want a fraction more warmth into it, so I'm going to take some white, and in this case a little touch of, cadmium orange. I just want to put a little bit more warmth into this sky, because this paint is all nice and dry now, so I can afford to do this without lifting too much colour underneath. And there we are, that gives us that little bit more lightness, a little bit more luminosity. Now I'm going to come down to the plants here and start painting in all of these textures, and for that I want to come back to my rake brush again, this lovely one with the raked ends, or the broken ends, and I'm going to mix up some medium tones, some yellow ochre, a little touch of green into it. I could put a little bit of blue in to do that, but I'm going to use a little bit of bright green in this case. We'll just test that out, look. Make sure there's enough water in, because the rake has to be able to just tickle on these lots of little stems here of the rape. I'm going to build up and build up and build up again. So, like I did with the last one, same technique, just to show you how it can be used with a different palette of colours. And not only are we going to do these verticals, these crisscrosses, we're going to come across them shortly as well. And then we start to get these little bits coming across. So I can use the brush not only sideways like that to get these shapes, but I can also use it sideways like that to get single ones like this, all the way across. There's a lot of building up to do at first, and already you see we've got the feeling of this drying off rape, dying drying off rape here in the background. Now I want to go a bit greener, so I'm going to take a little bit more of the light green. A wee touch of viridian into it, maybe even a little touch of turquoise. Brighter greens, livening things up a little bit, a And these greens are going to play nicely against the reds, because red is the opposite of green in the colour circle. Remember how Constable used it. Nearly all of his landscapes you'll find little red figures somewhere against the green of the landscape to bring out the greens. Little tricks of the trade. We're building up the sunlight, and the more I do this, the more you see sunlight appearing, or apparently starting to appear in the picture. So there's all sorts of ways we could do this painting, and this is just one of them. But look how effective it can be using a rake brush. It's a tangled web of these grasses. And I'm almost there. I'm going to add a little bit of white to that same colour now. A little bit more yellow into it. This time a little bit of chrome yellow. So white and chrome yellow this time. Start to get some of these slightly lighter tips to them. I'm going to use a little rigger in a minute to do some of these details, but at the moment I'm still able to just flick in some of these lighter colours with this. We've almost done enough with this particular brush now. I'll have to go into using a different one shortly. In the rigger. Right, I thought I might use some areas of white here later to bring up some much brighter poppies. At the moment I just want to start off working with fairly heavy paint and just see how we can get this red to go over here. It's going to sink back a bit. It's not going to be as bright as I would really like, but it's going to be all right just to build up these. You can see how I can just take the pure paint and tickle it along in little layers here to give the feeling of these. You can see how it's going darker over the green almost immediately. So I've got to use it a little bit thicker to try and get the brightness of colour with these. Which I wouldn't have this problem with oils, and this is why I do prefer oils in many ways for something like this. Now I could paint oils over these acrylics now. There's nothing to stop us from putting oils over acrylics, so that we can't do it the other way around, remember. Getting larger as they come towards us. It's rather fun. We can build up these larger poppies behind. Slightly larger marks, just by making brush strokes like this about the petals and the poppies. We're not trying to copy it, remember. We're not doing a copy, we're using the composition and the flowers. There we are, that's given us a nice feeling of those poppies. I have to let those dry off and work more colour over the top. Because if I'm going to get this vibrance, I've really got to have quite thick paint to get the purity of colour and stop this green breaking through. Just little strokes like this in the right places. Like I say with the jigsaw method, put the right colours in the right places and the right shapes and relevant one to another, and your picture should just appear. So my poppies should just appear if I just keep putting colours in the right places. Now I was talking about magenta earlier and our different reds. We want these reds to appear warmer, and we need to put some cooler reds into it. So I'm going to take some quite deep magenta. Just add that in on the centre of these roses here before I put some even cooler colours in. And look at that lovely red. How that makes such a difference in there, because it's a much more cooler, more purple red. So every colour has a warm and a cool, remember. And the reds, just the same, they'll be more purple or bluer or cooler reds. And there'll be more warmer reds, which are more orangey, such as the cadmiums. But rose and alizarin crimson and so on are cooler reds. Right, and yet again, still with my cool reds, let's take some pink, some quite bright pink, and we'll just add that to some of these areas to really give the feeling of the light glowing in amongst these. So again, some magenta, but really help these colours to sing a bit. As the light just glistens across the poppies. I can add a little bit of white to that magenta. Just catch some of the very highlights on some of the edges like this. And I also want to go a little bit warmer. So I'm going to clean my brush. Just pick up a bit of chrome yellow. We'll just see if there's anything slightly more orange on some of these edges here, just to make it a little bit warmer in places with the sunlight coming over. Really pick up these lovely warms and cools to get the feelings of the poppies. You know me, being an impressionist, I like to really play with the colours and make them glow. I think we're almost there with the basic colours on these. I don't think we're going to need to use white. It's sunk back a little bit, but got little bits of yellow going on here as well. Just one or two yellow flowers in there. Right, what I need now, I'm going to just go back with the rigger brush a minute and put some more light in, but what I need now is to look at these darker things in the middle of the poppies, these blues and purples. Just to take some purple, which will play beautifully against the yellows and reds. We'll drop a bit of this very deep, this wonderful purple in the middle here before I put some Prussian blue in. Purple's a little bit thin, it's not going on as well as I'd like. And then having got that, I'm going to go to my Prussian blue, very, very deep blue, and darkens further still to here with the deep blue. I'm going to go a bit warmer yet with that and add some brown to it to really get my colours singing. There we are, not far off. We'll let that dry a little, put in some darks with the rigger, and we'll just flick in some of these stances, showing them coming through, because there aren't many of them on here. Some of them come across each other, and it is rather fun. I would say we're about there on that painting. Don't need to do much more, it's pulling together. I may just flick in just one or two more little highlights here and there. It doesn't require much. Paintings finished and in the frames, they make a nice pair together, the yellows and the reds, don't they? And it just gives you an idea of how we can pick up some reasonably priced frames and then reuse them and choose a painting that might suit them.